Can we get started?
Yeah, you got a moment.
Yes, I do. I want to remember which way that I'm doing it, so. This is going to be the funnest part of my evening, is zooming in and out with the remote control. But anyway, welcome everyone to the Sussex Humanities Lab and to our collaborative event this evening for the Brighton Digital Festival 2021. My name is Dr. Sharon Webb. I'm a lecturer in the University of Sussex and a co-director of the Sussex Humanities Lab, where we are based this evening. I'm also PI for a new project called Full Stack Feminism in Digital Humanities, and I'll talk a little bit about that project kind of briefly. So I just wanted to say a few words before I hand over to Laurence, who is now over there, and you can't see on screen, but you will see on screen, who is a visiting fellow at the Sussex Humanities Lab and a long-term collaborator. Myself and Laurence have worked together over the last few years on various different projects, including a piece called Queer Code Breakers, which sits in the Brighton Hove Museum. So, you know, we've been working together for a few years now. So it's brilliant that we're able to kind of collaborate on this event too. So for anyone who hasn't been to the Sussex Humanities Lab or have yet to hear about us, we are an interdisciplinary research programme at the University of Sussex, which is in Falmer, just outside Brighton, that investigates the interactions between computational technology, culture, society and environment. We are a collective of academics, artists, coders, creative practitioners, information professionals, as well as art makers, programmers, scholars, and theorists. Our shared endeavors inspire us to imagine and to create more sustainable and equitable and inclusive futures for all. So SHL members currently span across the arts and humanities, across informatics, social sciences, and the library. And our research interests range from community archives to artificial intelligence, to media theory, to conservation, to critical heritage, to intersectionality and feminism, and from digital humanities to experimental music technology and critical making. And part of the work that we've been doing over the last year or so has been to kind of highlight a number of research areas within the lab. And we've designed these around six priority areas, and I can put a link on the chat in a little bit. But one of those priority areas we've identified is intersectionality, community and computational technology. So it's ICCT for short, you know, keep it short. And this priority area in particular highlights and challenges and disrupts the way in which computational technology reproduces and reinforces various inequalities in society. So we can see how an event like this kind of is really important to the types of work that we're trying to do in that priority area. And then linked to that priority area and part of, as I said, the kind of work of the lab is a newly emerged Arts Council, AHRC and IRC, which is the Irish Research Council funding. It's a two-year project called Full Stack Feminism in Digital Humanities. And within that project, we want to embed intersectional feminist methodologies within digital humanities. It will achieve this by developing an interoperable, what we're calling full stack feminist methodology and toolkit. And it develops this approach by focusing on three areas. And the areas that we focus on, which we refer to as stacks, are data and archives, infrastructure, tools and code, access, experience and integration. And we use full stack as a metaphor with the understanding that this term has specific uses and meaning in software development. We use it in a similar but not precisely equivalent way. So in kind of thinking about the lab and the priority area and full stack feminism, and the opportunity to work with Laurence on this event was obviously very appealing and kind of fits in with some of the priorities, our values and our ethos as a lab and as various projects. So coinciding then with the Brighton Digital Festival felt like a very useful and important collaboration. As I said, it exemplifies some of the trajectory of the lab, the questions and provocations we want to embed in our research and our practice. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Laurence as I zoom across the room. the right way.
Thank you, Sharon. Firstly, I just wanted to say thanks to Sharon and Cecile for asking me to be a part of making this event happen. I'm very happy to be here in person in the lab, but also it's great to see so many of you. Well, I can see your names, not faces, but familiar names, unfamiliar names. It's great that you've been able to join us this evening. I hope you'll enjoy it. I know I will. There's a lot of richness here. I'm happy too that this event is part of Brighton Digital Festival, with which I have a long history going back to its inception in 2011. I'm no longer involved, but it feels good to have this event be part of its 10th edition. So my name is Laurence Hill. I'm a curator, a lecturer at the University of Brighton on the Digital Media Arts MA. I'm also, importantly for tonight, a visiting research fellow at the School of Media Arts and Humanities, and specifically here at the Sussex Humanities Lab. One of the things that I've always wanted to do is to bring digital artists into this space. And I mean literally this space, but also metaphorically this space. We're researching, questioning the impacts of technology on us, our cultures, our societies, is happening every day. Because there are many artists who are asking the same kinds of questions from different perspectives and with different motivations, and they're making different realities. I think there's enormous richness and potential in bringing together artists and researchers, so this will be the first of, I hope, many such events, and we have two exceptional artists here this evening. Unfortunately, AM Doc is not able to join us because of some time difference anomalies and scheduling conflicts, and I'm very sorry about that. And though you won't see them this evening, I would highly recommend going to their website to look at their work. The website is pretty dark, and that's dark with an E, dot cool. Maybe Sharon, you could put that in the chat. And I particularly look at their ongoing project, the open source Afro Hair Library, which they would have presented this evening, and which addresses questions of limited representations of Black people in online spaces. I'm a very, very poor substitute, but I wanted to quote a little from their website on this project. So, quote, "The open source Afro Hair Library is a free, user-friendly, highly curated 3D model database of Black hairstyles and textures. It is a feminist, anti-racist resource for digital artists and 3D content creators. Functioning as both art practice and technological development, the open source Afro Hair Library seeks to address the lack of thoughtful representation of Blackness in games, virtual and augmented realities, and other 3D media." It's a really fascinating and really important project, and I really highly recommend that you go and check it out if you can. However, we do have two fantastic artists here, Teresa Braun, who's joining us from Montreal, and Jake Elwes, who is sitting here right next to me in this room. They'll do a much better job of introducing themselves and their work than I can. But as I introduce them, I wanted to share some of my curatorial process. It might be a little oversharing, but you can decide. As a curator and a punter of digital art, I see a lot of work, which is undoubtedly a privilege, and I have a sort of internal triage process by which I categorize work. Inevitably, there is work that I don't like for whatever reason. Then there is work that makes me go, well, that's cool, but then it doesn't really require a lot more thought. Then there are certain artists and works that I flat out love. It's work that resonates at a pitch that sends my brain into overdrive and honestly makes me feel a bit sick, which sounds weird, but that's a good thing, because it hits me both intellectually and on a gut level. It's the work I can't get enough of and I want to show and to promote. So Teresa and Jake are two of those artists whose work has made me feel really sick. And I do genuinely mean that as a compliment. I met Jake through the Lumen Prize, where he was shortlisted a couple of years ago, and I curated a show, I think in 2018. And I showed one of Jake's pieces then, and I showed him again the following year. And these are the kind of two extremes of how you meet artists. So I met Jake through the Lumen Prize. I met Teresa because she used to live next door to my cousin in New York, and my cousin thought that we'd get on and that we should talk to each other. So we did, and we are having an ongoing conversation, which makes me happy. So that's enough from me. So I'm going to hand over to Teresa to get us started this evening.
Okay, hello. Thank you, Laurence, for that introduction. The idea that I can nauseate people with my work is thrilling and exciting. So I'm thrilled that's happened for you. Can everybody hear me okay? Yeah, all right. And thank you as well, Sharon, for putting this together, and the work you're doing there sounds so exciting. So I'm looking forward to ongoing collaborations and sharing work together. So I'm going to share my screen. Give me one moment here. Okay, and everyone can see this, right?
Yeah.
Okay, great. I'll try and just keep people on this side here. All right, so obviously, as the topic is today, I'm talking about subverting digital spaces. As Laurence said, my name is Teresa Braun. I use they, them, theirs pronouns, and I'm currently a guest on the Geojage land, otherwise known as Montreal. And I'm here in Montreal, doing a research creation PhD within the humanities department at the University of Concordia. And I just moved here from, as Laurence said, New York. I'm Canadian, but was living in the States for 8 years. And I'll talk briefly about what it was like to be there during the Trump disaster. Okay, so I'm going to kind of position myself through my performance work, which is both live and has digital aspects as well. So as a non-binary person, I really understand part of my identity through multiple performance identities. So I think of it as a space for activism, storytelling, exploring family history. So here are a few different manifestations of that. On the left is my drag king character, who's kind of a far right pseudo politician within the American scene. His name is Peter Funk. In the middle is Egregious Philbin, who I think of as kind of a post-gender shapeshifter. And then on the right, this is an image from a video project I did where I superimposed myself onto the bodies of each of my family members. And sort of awkwardly reenacted their bodies and our family stories through a representation of myself. Okay, and in terms of, I guess, the theory I'm coming from, I read Glitch Feminism by Legacy Russell, a manifesto, this past year, and I was just so taken with her call and her proposition that glitch, both digital and physical glitch, is a space for social revolution. She talks as well, and this is where I'm really interested in, about gender as a technological invention, rather than a construction that reflects something intrinsically about us and who we are as humans. So she talks about how new technologies, any technology, simultaneously brings into being new breakdowns, failures, and cracks. So for example, computers brought us the digital glitch, and gender glitches can be physical, virtual, visible, invisible. And the question I'm really interested in is, if we're understanding gender as technology that's constantly breaking down, what social revolutions can be built in its cracks? I'm going to pause here. I'm not able to see anybody, and it's very distracting for me. So I'm going to try and change my view. Sorry. Okay. Sorry. Apologies. Well, I just won't see you, which is fine. I'll see you at the end.
Teresa, I can unspotlight you if you want to see people, maybe.
I would just love to see people at the site, even if it's just their names.
Yeah.
Is there a show video panel option? That should do it on your screen, Teresa.
Am I looking at this?
Yeah, more show video panel.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you so much. All right. So moving along. So this is Peter Funk. So he, and I talk about him in the third person, came into being right after Trump was elected. Again, I was living in the States at the time. So this was a whole project where I didn't just perform and I held campaign rallies, but I also produced business cards, buttons, I passed them out. So this is a screenshot of a business card. So he's in the center, on his left and right, also me. Is Elizabeth White Privilege. So a little knows, but she was kind of the Kellyanne Conway to his Trumpism. So just a way of satirizing to the highest possible degree what was going on there at the time. And I was also at the time making Peter Funk Muse. So what I was doing here was taking specifically Fox News clips and inserting Peter Funk into those dialogues as this sort of talking head. So here's Tucker Carlson, Jeff Sessions with Peter in the middle. And what I found also really interesting about these digital interventions is that the language they were using was semiotically so circular and nonsensical that it actually was quite easy to remix it a little bit and kind of put in whatever sort of language I wanted, and it still read about as coherently as Fox News itself does. What I was also doing was, so this is an anatomy lesson with Peter Funk, again, a video. So taking found footage, kind of documentary films describing the anatomy of the human body, often in a very gendered way, and then inserting him and his rhetoric in on top of that. You know, he's very sexist, he's very essentialist and a fan of the binary. So, you know, just taking those ideas and pushing them to the highest degree to again satirize those structures and ways that we are told to understand our bodies. And here's a little bit about Egregious Philbin. I won't talk too much about this performance in particular, but just wanted to give you a visualization of Egregious as a performer. So very different than Peter Funk. I do a lot of these layered costumes and think of it really as storytelling, often as kind of flipping through and subverting gender. So this was set to Fake Plastic Trees, a Radiohead song, and it's a drag act. And it was shot by Rachel Rampleman earlier this summer for her Life is Drag series. Here's another Egregious Philbin act. So again, kind of layered costumes and storytelling. I think of this really as a physical glitch within the body, within my body, that then kind of can enter a digital space. So here, and I'm really interested in biblical literalism within Catholicism. So if you're taking communion, you're literally eating and drinking Jesus. So here it was, I start out as this nun, turn into a Roman soldier, stab myself in the chest, pour wine out of my chest, pull some bread out of my pants. I turn into an evangelical preacher and then eat and drink the communion that's just come forth from my body in a very literal way. And what's interesting is that people find this act kind of shocking, but they tend not to find the Bible shocking. And I find the Bible more shocking than most drag I see. Okay, so I'm going to jump ahead to some of my digital work. So these were some AR lenses that I made kind of at the start of pandemic, I think April 2020. So myself and obviously any other performance artist and all humans in general were asking ourselves, we're asking ourselves, like, how do we exist? How do we perform in digital spaces? So this was around the time people were turning themselves into that banana on Zoom through Snap Camera. You might remember that. So I took that software, which is Lens Studio and Snap Camera, and started making these kind of weird versions of those and then uploading them to the Snap Camera app. with the idea that, you know, someone might stumble along onto this alongside a filter designed to make you look really hot, and it could be some kind of intervention in that space. Okay, here's just another quick one, another example. And then what I did next is I brought that technology into actual performances. So especially really early on in the pandemic, a lot of drag performers were really enthusiastic about using Zoom, often not very successfully, to replicate something that would have happened in real life. So I was trying to just figure out some way in which I could discover what was possible on something like Zoom in terms of performance. So here was one attempt at that. I'll just play this video. Give me a thumbs up if the sound is okay.
Mars ain't the kind of place to raise your kids. In fact, it's cold as hell. And there's no one there to raise them. If you did, and all the science I don't understand, it's just my job 5 days a week. A rocket.
So just a quick and the idea there, in case it's not clear, is that I'm doing a lip sync. My face is animating the AR filter. And then, you know, I created a backing video, I had a green screen. And what I really loved there, first time I was able to do this, obviously, was to have to multiply myself and be my own choir in a lip sync was really fun. Oh, next one. All right. So what that also made me think about is what is beyond the physical queer body and how else can it be animated? So the AR lenses being one example. So many trans people, non-binary people, including myself, we've complicated relationships to our bodies. And the queer community can reflect so that fat phobia, ableism, and other isms that are present in all facets of society. And so often when I see work by queer people, by trans people, I mean, we use our bodies and I love doing this, but I really wondered like what other forms of digital embodiment are possible. What I also started doing at this point is going into social VR. This was also a pandemic side effect. It was not something I ever thought I would do. But I found myself there and fell into this really interesting world of trans and non-binary people using virtual embodiment to explore their identities. So here's a clip from a VR chat podcast. It's one of the largest social VR networks. And it's somebody, O-Girls is the name of the person who does the podcast, talking with their friend Kanata, who is a dancer in VR chat. About love, communication, and being mute. So mute, meaning that they're embodied in this world within a VR headset with body trackers. They dance, but they don't speak. Typically, here they're speaking. So I'll just play this clip. Oops.
I'm mute because I don't think that Kanata should have this voice, which in a sense was like, you know, not being able to accept who I was and sort of hating.
Can you hear that on your end?
Yep.
Who I really was, and seeing, going to TwitchCon and seeing my friends and seeing how everybody just acted the same around me and loved me for who I was, made me wonder, you know, maybe one day I can learn to love myself like they love me, the real me. The relationships we make as a mute is so much more, is so much stronger. For example, when I communicate with my other mute friends, we don't use words, we don't use dictionary words, we use our body language. So once you learn your friend's body language, I feel like you'll get to know exactly how they feel. It's very true and honest. If I think about it, like the friends that I feel the closest to, like I feel like we get each other on almost like a, you know, mind reading level. It's my mute friends, and we just immediately get each other without having to say anything or express anything.
So I found that really interesting. You know, this idea that they're able to achieve such intimacy with their friends with just body trackers in VR, which is, anyway, I found it fascinating. And I couldn't really find other people who were doing research or, you know, field work in this way. So that became part of the theme of my PhD project. How am I doing for time?
Yeah, I think you're okay.
Fine.
Yeah, you're fine.
Okay. All right, so I'll talk a little bit about my PhD project, which is called Virtual Queerality. So I started to think of VR as a space to develop, express, and share underrepresented experiences of trans people. So what I'm doing is workshops and creative collaborations and interviews with trans people in order to create this kind of living archive populated with avatars we've built together and then animated with their oral histories. So, you know, this idea that it could be this utopian world. And I really take seriously this idea of utopianism, you know, calling upon Jose Esteban Munoz, who's talked about the importance of that kind of visioning, of that kind of futuring, and that optimism too. And I think it's essential. I mean, we're entering a time where, you know, Facebook just announced Meta, whatever the hell that is. So I think it's really important to kind of step in at this time as an activist and say, like, you know, there's something else possible, kind of push on those edges. This was an avatar developed for myself, or Egregious Philbin. And here's a little quote from an interview I did speaking with someone else participating in my project. So for me, experiencing my voice embedded in an avatar offers a whole new set of sensations. So I can stand in front of myself, listen, speak back, turn around, enter my own voice, physically walk into it. And that really felt to me like I had potential for queer expression, especially if I'm thinking of myself in terms of multiple identities. You know, it offered this whole new way of encountering myself. Someone else I'm working with is Josephine Simple. So we developed this Beetle avatar together. This stuff is all built in Unity, by the way, just 3D naming platform, software development. So what they talked about is realizing that they were trans was hindered by a lack of stories and metaphors that were applicable to them. So they had heard about this idea that there's one way of being trans and feels that's very harmful and keeps people from understanding themselves. Also this metaphor of talking about the person they used to be as a dead person, they don't find that applicable to themselves, and said, I don't feel like the shift in how I understand my gender was the most important change in my identity. I change all the time. So something that was interesting them too was, you know, starting out as this beetle and then the potential to morph into different creatures as they move through this space within this avatar, which is animated with a recording of their story. So having access to those two types of expression simultaneously. Here's another person I'm working with, Chevy Lace, who's a drag performer. So when I asked them how they imagined themselves in VR, they said, I become very existential. So what does this core part of my soul look like without having to look human? Originally, they imagined something that looks like Chevy in performance, but now I imagine something that's constantly shifting and evolving. I want the movement to be non-human, expand, contract, ripple. So what we did here is took a prefab avatar and then glitched it with animations, with other prefab animations that were not intended to be placed on that rig. So when you see this avatar moving, it's like the hip swings out in a strange way, the arms move strangely. And it also has these visual animations on it that glitches and obscures different parts of the body. And then finally, I'll just show a couple images of another iteration of this project. This is all kind of preliminary research at this point, or early versions of the project, I'll say. So I'm working as well in Mozilla Hub. So it's a very accessible form of web VR. So here's a kind of hallway or exhibition I made together with someone named Germ. And so what we're able to do here is enter this space simultaneously, and they can put their artwork on the wall, and we can move and build things together and draw together. So a quote from them that if you go into this space, you'll hear is, "I have the same experience of gender as I do of music or sound in a room. Multiple sounds build a chord that can be felt in the body. I started feeling my gender identity in that way. And once I could communicate with my body in a way that felt loving and pleasurable, all the theoretical stuff around my identity fell into place." So another thing that felt really important to me as I started talking with other people is they're not just stories of trauma, which we often hear the stories of trans trauma. And there's so much joy and love and euphoria available and within the bodies of trans people. And, you know, how can we celebrate that? And I think that's another version of utopianism and something that I also saw in the social VR. And then finally, just a visualization of how I am making things with people. So this is, again, in Mozilla Hubs. It's very lo-fi looking, but somatically, I think, really exciting that we can be in a space together, sculpt and draw things together that could potentially become 3D models for avatars. One other thing that I've been doing lately that's very fun is to use a headset, go into this space, and I can draw and sculpt around my actual body. So it's very somatically powerful to be able to do that, change the scale. I could pick up that drawing, place it on the virtual body of another person. So as this technology continues to evolve, I think there's a lot of exciting potential there for queer expression. Thank you. That's all I have.
Thanks so much, Teresa. I would say that we'll have time at the end for questions. If anyone feels awkward asking a question live, they can put it into the chat and we can pose it to Teresa and Jake. But thanks, Teresa, that was fantastic. And a big thumbs up for the Legacy Russell book, Glitch Feminism book, which is fantastic. Jake.
Yeah, shall I take it away? Okay, let me get this set up.
Zoom in.
Cool, no, that was fantastic, Teresa, to hear about your research and your art. I feel like we've got I'm echoing, I think. Can you hear me? I can't see. Actually, I can see Teresa there, but then it's... Should I hide that? I'm just wondering, same problem as Teresa. I've got these people in the room behind me, but they're behind me.
hold on.
Oh, we could put them in a grid though. Does that work?
Yeah.
But then will that be in the stream?
No.
But yeah, fascinating, really fascinating, Teresa, to hear about your research. I think we've got a lot in common and we're very much on the same wavelength and a lot of crossover with a lot of the things we're thinking about. I'm also investigating drag performance and I'm kind of using drag as a way of subverting these spaces, these technical spaces. And for me, I'm much more focused on artificial intelligence and machine learning and trying to kind of demystify and pick apart what this AI thing is, with the introduction of queer expression and queer voices and queer identities. So these videos you're watching right now, this is basically injecting 1,000 images of drag performers, drag kings, drag queens, drag things, into a standardized and homogenous data set of 70,000 images of human faces, which is used as a standard to train facial recognition systems. So that data set contains very little of this otherness. Is, you know, as we all know, I think facial recognition systems are often very bad at performing on women of color, on trans people, on queerness, on otherness. So the idea behind this project was, what happens, yeah, if we just take, it's only 1,000, it's called fine tuning. You basically retrain it by injecting 1,000 images of drag performers, and this shifts all of the weights in this neural network from a space of kind of heteronormativity into this space of queerness, and this queer celebration. And I guess, yeah, it's sort of thinking this question through whether we actually want to be represented in the first place. You know, who is it that owns the data, and who are these systems being built for? So I guess there's constantly that question as well. Do we kind of want to be included, or do we want to try and obfuscate these systems and try and queer them and break them down and kind of disrupt them, if you like? So I'm going to talk a little bit more about how that piece was made, but first I want to try and kind of demystify some of the terms around AI through a kind of queer drag lens. So that's how I'm going to start. So, oh, can I control these? So the first concept, which really excites me as an artist, is this idea of a latent space. Because actually I wrote an article for Laurence recently.
I was going to ask you about that later.
So in AI, in machine learning, when you're using a convolutional neural network, so a neural network that has been trained on tens of hundreds of thousands, millions of images, what it's effectively doing is it's trying to classify all of these images in spatial dimensions. So it will say all of the images of trees kind of exist up here in this space, and all of the images of birds exist down here, and all of the images of, like, I don't know, dogs and cats kind of exist over here. And it's learnt specific features in those images. It doesn't have to be images. It could also be with language, or it could be with music or financial data or whatever you want. But it's also, yeah, what they would use for facial recognition. So if we're trying to classify, this is an image of a woman, this is an image of a man, it has plotted what it thinks female faces to look like as a place in this latent space, and what it thinks male faces to look like in another place, what it thinks black faces and white faces, and all of these different identities, which we train it on by giving it labels in the data set, it starts to plot them in this multidimensional mathematical space. Now, for me, this was such a beautiful concept because I actually think there's an inherent queerness to this idea of a latent space. Because what it does is, when it's learned from all of these images, it just reduces them to, let's say, 500 numbers, which is where this face exists in this space. And that is between male and female and race. And it's this kind of fluid space of potentiality. And again, like talking of Munoz, kind of utopias, like actually there's this kind of beauty and poetry in reducing things to mathematical coordinates, which are actually devoid of human classifications and human binaries. So that was kind of the first concept. I've got a kind of couple of examples of latent spaces. So here is a visualization of a latent space of the IKEA catalog. So all of these images, can't actually zoom in on this, I don't think, but you can kind of see they're pretty tiny, but I think we've got like fridges in the middle, beds on the left side. And this latent space is actually a multi-dimensional space, but you can squish it to two dimensions to visualize it, or three dimensions. And I love that. So it's learned kind of what all these images have in common just by looking at these images of things. So here, this is, again, a really beautiful concept. You can actually do this same thing for the whole of the human language. So you can say, "What? Let's take the corpus of the internet and look at when words are used, you know, in common with each other." And an AI can effectively learn the semantic meaning of these words as mathematical coordinates in space. So this is the 512 dimensions, numbers, that correspond to the human vector. So in this latent space, that is where human exists. And I've kind of been doing some experiments and saying, you know, around the word human or around the word queer or around the word faggot, kind of what other words exist and how do they exist spatially? And you can start to learn all sorts of fascinating things and infer bias through language, kind of looking at these things spatially. So I was mentioning earlier about using facial recognition systems, using image classification systems. And let's say we plot kind of all of these images of faces in a space. The way that this is working is using what's called a convolutional neural network. So it's kind of looking across these images and it will then start to plot these images, like I say, in points in space. Now, Ian Goodfellow, I think back in 2013, was it? Found that you can do this rather ingenious thing with a CompNet, which is that you can reverse engineer it. And this is kind of where deepfakes come from, right? So you can start to create a fake face. You can fool this network, this convolutional neural network that's really good at saying this is a picture of a human face and this isn't a picture of a human face. If you pair this whole system with what's called a GAN, a generative adversarial network, and you basically start with random noise, and you have a generator network that knows nothing about what the human face looks like, and then you have a discriminator, and again, I think the words are really interesting in this, like discriminating, there's something, I don't know, interestingly coded in that, this whole idea of like images parsing. If we're trying to create a deep fake image, you know, the neural network is trying to iterate and create images that, to pass as human, and I think that's a really interesting thing, similar to the Turing test of let's pass, like Turing being a queer man, it kind of makes sense. They've come up with this whole concept of passing. That's this idea that you can create these fake kind of simulacra, let's say, faces. And what it does is it picks a point in a latent space and you say, now try and generate an image of what might exist there. And that might be kind of in the space of more feminine faces or more black faces or more, you know, men in their 30s with big noses face or whatever it is. And you can kind of maximize to try and create a new fake image of that. So that was kind of what I've been exploring for the last few years. And this was my first attempt at a GAN at trying to create a image of the Buddha trained on 8,000 images, I think it was, of the Buddha. It's a reference to Nam June Paik's famous video piece where it's a Buddha looking at its own reflection in a CCTV feed. And the AI completely failed to create a representation of the Buddha. It created these kind of really strange abstract images that were the kind of artifacts of the AI that hadn't learned what the Buddha looked like. And that was kind of my fault. I didn't give it enough data. I didn't train it. You know, the latent space that existed hadn't kind of learned what the Buddha was, so it just kind of created these abstract expressionist images. So that was my first attempt in 2016 at using these technologies. Kind of built on a bit from there. One of the other early pieces that I created, which was quite fun, which kind of built on top of a researcher called Gabriel Goh, who found that what you can do is you can take Yahoo's algorithm at the time for removing pornography in their search engines and back engineer it to generate the most pornographic porn. Which again, maybe is quite a sort of queer move to kind of finding a way of like subverting these systems and doing something that it was definitely not originally intended to do. So I've put a little warner user discretion. There's actually also a video of this, which I'm not going to show because I don't want this stream to be removed from YouTube, but you can watch it on my website, jakeelwes.com. So here are some images of the computer kind of 99.9% pornography. And what's fascinating here is it's just kind of created images of genitalia blobs, but the neural network that had learned to remove porn hadn't been told the difference between male genitalia and female genitalia, just been given a big image data set of this is all just pornographic. And what it learned was like, okay, pornographic things have these kind of genitalia fleshy blobs in them. So it didn't know, like it doesn't know that this is the penis or this is the vagina, that these images are intersex, they're queer, it's moving through this latent space of the kind of potentiality of like what could be in between. And it's a video which is constantly morphing through these different shapes and forms, maybe quite white. Someone pointed that out to me recently, that, you know, trained on a corpus of internet pornography, it would be quite white. But again, yes, it's very penetrative, but it doesn't really know the difference between different sexualities and different genitalias. So anyway, moving on from there, I've got quite a lot to get through, so we might need to speed through some of this. This was my querying the dataset project, which I showed a little video of from the beginning. So I mentioned before, I took a normative dataset of 70,000 images, and these are the fake images of faces that it could create. Which at the time, I think in 2019, this was kind of the state of the art StyleGAN technology. I think they've got better and better since then. But again, it's definitely in that uncanny space where they do really pass as people. But you know, this data set contained very few images really of people of color or queers or otherness. So again, taking that, injecting 1,000 drag performers into it, and it moves from these images directly to these images. So you can do that again. You can see kind of back and forth. So maximizing the kind of queer vector, if you like, for all of these faces. And here again is a bit of it moving. So this video is showing in a few places at the moment. It's just opened in the Science Gallery in Dublin, and it's in Shanghai as well. So from that, I'm going to take a breather for a second and play you a very short section of a video. I guess thinking about, you know, the data, the heteronormativity in this, we've also obviously got to be thinking about who it is that is gathering this data. So here is a little video that I created called Dada Data in collaboration with a machine learning algorithm. And this is actually what these people said in the order that they said them. I've just removed a few other words. So here we go.
100 million, 2 billion, 1, 200,
250, 71,
10,000, 150, 10,000, 18,000, 10,
16,
16,
350, 20, 100, 2,
2, 2,
20, 350, 50,
10, 50,
9,000,
9,000, 1,000,
1, 6 billion, 100 million, 100 million, 100 million, 600, 100 million, 1, 1, 10
billion,
5, 30 million, 1, 3, 2, 27 million, 2, 100,
1,
1,
5, 30,000, 0, 1,
10,
10,000, 10,000,
3, 3,
3 or 400 billion, 1 trillion,
382, 350,000,
350,
420,
10, 1, 3 trillion, 17, 400 trillions, 5 millions, 1, tens of thousands, millions, 500 billion, 15, 4, 6 trillion, 2 million, 5,000, 50 billion, 64, 55,
1 billion, 80,
40,
10, 0, 3, 1,
400 million, 4 billion,
1, 4 billion, 1980s, 1, 4 billion, 1980s, 300 million, 10, 15 billion,
13,000, 1,500, 1,500, 25 million, 1 billion, 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 2 billion, 2, 7 billion, 4, 4 billion, 1, 1, 185, 10, 10,
400 million, 24, 25,
1, 10, 5, 5, 5, 500 billion, 200, 1,500, 1,000, 100.
1, 2, 3.
Oh, there we go. Mic stop with Mark. All right, so yeah, you can watch a bit more of it on my websites again. But these are, I think it was Forbes' 20 most powerful and influential figures in technology at the time, all white men apart from Jack Ma. So yeah, moving on from there. So now I'm going to talk a bit more about this drag project. So the ZZ project is what I've labeled it. So I've shown you kind of the first piece, if you like, querying the data set. From there, I really wanted to start to work with my friends in the drag community. My boyfriend holds a PhD in drag performance, and we're kind of quite tied into the London drag scene. So kind of thinking about how can we actually use these technologies, deep fake technologies, which are generally used to oppress and exploit in unconsensual ways. How can we use it and flip it to use it as a tool to empower a marginalized community, and as a kind of performance tool to, you know, celebrate and challenge and kind of think about what can AI teach drag, and, you know, how can we rethink performance using these tools, but also what can drag performance teach AI? And actually, you know, quite a few researchers have picked up on this and kind of thinking again about how we kind of think of positive utopias, kind of think about these latent spaces. What the hell should I introduce? ZZ, oh yeah, the project itself, the ZZ project, has been going on for the last 3 years. We had the help of the Edinburgh Futures Institute, who helped us kind of create an online web interactive version through lockdown when we weren't able to create a stage version. But that kind of became the ZZ show, which took 13 drag performers, and I'll show you that in a second. ZZ, the name came from the Z vector, which is how you interface with the latent space and with an AI and control it, and the Z pronoun, the non-binary pronoun. It's also French for Willy, which we quite like. So here is my first experiment in actually using kind of deepfake technology. So deepfake technology builds on top of what I was talking about before again, but it's the idea that you can actually control the figure. And this is our first experiment in doing that. So you can see here, this was trained on Vogue and on ballroom dance, and then trained on a data set of performers at the Royal Vauxhall Tavern at Bar Whatever, which a few of my friends are involved in. So you can see, and it kind of creates these wonderfully painterly, I don't know, sort of Velasquez paintings or something. It does something rather interesting. Actually, I should push this a bit further. This was kind of an early experiment, if you like. So I want to play you now a short video which kind of introduces the project itself. I might not play the full thing, but let's see. So it was performed and voiced by my main collaborator on the project, who's called Me the Drag Queen. And she's one of London's top drag performers. She's actually mentored and got over 100 drag performers that I think she's mentored through the London drag scene. So she's fantastic performer, and she's kind of been with me from the start. So this was a performance that she did, performing as herself, but as also 13 other performers that were involved in the project. So I'll play a little bit of this.
Meine Damen und Herren, Mesdames and Messieurs, ladies, gentlemen, and everyone between and beyond the binary, welcome to the ZZ Show. An interactive digital drag cabaret where from performer to performance, you get to choose your show. Through the magic and mystery of artificial intelligence, we will create a deep fake bespoke drag experience especially for you on our virtual stage. Now, my darlings, AI systems often inherit the bias of the cis white heteronormative patriarchy that controls our society. But here at the ZZ Show, we plan to disrupt the dataset by flooding it with a myriad of marvelous queer drag bodies. So without further ado, that's French, sit back, relax, get your clicking fingers at the ready as we begin the ZZ Show!
Better meet myself. So that's the ZZ Show. It's actually, you can go and watch it online at zz.ai. The whole thing is up there, and you can switch between the performers as you watch it. So I want to quickly talk about how we actually built these deepfake bodies. It's kind of an interesting process, and I think it's actually quite important that as an artist exploring this technology, that we do our part to try and demystify this tech and kind of try and maybe, in a way, this whole project is kind of doing something a bit fun and satirical, where, you know, the thing that I detest the most in many ways is this idea that an AI is something that we could mistake for a human, because I think it's actually quite dangerous. And we often have this narrative, a lot of fear-mongering going on around Terminator robots, or, you know, trying to anthropomorphize these systems. But of course, you know, by making an AI drag queen, I am literally doing that, but I'm hoping to kind of use a constructed identity, which is drag, and then construct an identity on top of that through deep fakes, and then try and sort of deconstruct that by showing the process behind the making of it, and hopefully open up this conversation. Because I think, you know, people in the AI world, is not a very accessible world unless you're an academic or unless you work in industry, but then it's all black boxed. Or in the fine art world, again, not a hugely accessible world, but I think drag is, being a popular art form, is so accessible that it's kind of a wonderful place that we can have these conversations. So to make a deepfake, Well, you start off by creating your data set. So for us, we went into a photo studio during lockdown to a queer venue in Farringdon, the Apple Tree, and we filmed drag performers from every different angle. We kind of get them to move around the room, and that would become our data set, every frame of that video. So this is Lily Snatch Dragon moving around the room. So once we have that data set, the next thing that we do is we skeleton track it. So we turn them into a reduced number of points, which again, maybe has its problems to do with sort of dance analysis and fascism. We're not going to go there today, although we've had those conversations with plenty. So this is Lily kind of, yeah, being reduced to a skeleton. Now, the way the actual deepfakes work is, so it's the same idea as GAN, a generative adversarial network, but instead of starting at with random noise at a random point in latent space, you use a different input, and that input is the skeleton, right? So if we start with our original image in the top left, we then have our skeleton on the top right, the middle is what's being generated. And it's what's being generated not being able to see the original image, only being able to see the skeleton, right? So you can see at the moment, it doesn't really look like Lily, but it's kind of learned the purple colors, right? So as it iterates, it gets given a score, and it says, from that skeleton, the image you are generating is 90% close to the original image. And that's how the model is trained. So you can see over time, it iterates, and it gets better and better and better at creating a deep fake Lily Snapdragon. There we go, until it's 99.9% sure that it's Lily after 20,000 iterations, about 3 days of training on the laptop at the end of my bed. So that's a deep fake Lily. So here we go, you kind of see Lily evolving from basic to this, yeah, much more realized version of what Lily looks like. So once you have that model, you can then do something amazing, which is it can be all this virtual deepfake of Lily, and it can look almost hyper-realistic. Of course, that's incredibly problematic because someone can go and create fake news. I mean, we decided for this project we needed it to be a closed system. We didn't want anyone to control Lily Snapdragon's body who wasn't part of our community, part of our scene. And yeah, I think we've thought about that at points, like could we have a camera and there's a live demo and you can sort of be moving as a drag performer, but actually part of the integrity of this project is that it's not kind of exploiting. Everything is done consensually, and to do it all consensually, we wanted to make sure that everyone knew who was going to be manipulating each other's forms. So here is me, the drag queen, controlling Lily Snapdragon's figure. We created models in full length, and we also created models close up, so we could get a far more kind of intricate, you know, image of them actually lip syncing and performing. So the last thing that we did for this project, which is quite fun, is as well as the 13 performers, and we had some brilliant performers. Lily Snapdragon has been voted one of the top burlesque performers in the country. She's a female drag queen. We had Chio, who's an extraordinary drag king, who's been nominated for Mr. Gay England, first trans man to be nominated. And just some really, really fantastic, who else? Can't list everyone, TT Bang, Mahatma Candy. Anyway, yeah, some really, really brilliant talent, super exciting. And hopefully we're gonna kind of carry on bringing more people into the cast as this project carries on. We're gonna take it to a few museums. So we'll hopefully be bringing in more and more people and paying people for their data. That's the other thing, you know. It's not just not consensual but manipulating people's bodies. It's also unconsensual how the data is gathered. So, you know, we made a big point of actually wanting to pay our performers through lockdown. So the last thing that we did was we took all 13 drag forms and we created amalgamations. So I created a deep fake that was trained on all of their bodies at once, and it confused this system and broke this system. And again, like we talk about, it's this idea of kind of using these systems for something they weren't intended to be used for. So when an engineer is creating a system like this, they are thinking about functionality, about how well does it perform to do the job it's made to do. But as an artist, you can kind of take a critical step back from that and find poetry in when it breaks down and fails. And there is this, again, this whole queer art of failure, which I find really interesting. I think for the drag performance, that was often the most exciting thing as well, is kind of seeing when these things broke down. So kind of, yeah, thinking about the failures within these systems and finding poetry, but also kind of the underlying technology used to make these systems kind of through when they don't really function. And as an artist, I can kind of make them do these things because I don't have any culpability. It can be purposeless. So yeah. All right, tiny bit more video here. There we go. So there's the ZZ Show in its full glory, performed by Ruby Wednesday, running... I'm echoing, sorry. That was 5 years, performed by the amazing Ruby Wednesday, who was doing the movement, and then we had 13 performers following their movement. So yeah, you can go and look at the work on zz.ai, my website, jakeelwes.com. I'm just thinking, I've got one little other video that I could show, but I was going to see how we were doing for time. What do you think? It's about a minute and a half. About a minute.
Yeah.
Okay, let's do it. So the final iteration of the ZZ project, if you like, or not the final one, it's kind of still growing, but another strand is a duet that I've been doing. So this is me, the drag queen, and we're having a lot of fun with this at the moment. So it's thinking about creating a deep fake clone of a performer, but then also having the live performer in the room and getting them to kind of duet with each other. And hopefully kind of through that duet, thinking maybe in quite a tongue-in-cheek way of how we can kind of satirize, you know, society's relationship with humanity. Society's relationship with AI. So this idea that AI is something that we might mistake for a human, and AI is something that's kind of coming to take over all of our jobs, I think as a distraction to maybe the rather more insidious ideas of, you know, who are these systems being built by and who are these systems being built for. So anyway, this is ZZ and me, and we've been, yeah, like having a lot of fun with it, and we're going to hopefully bring it to stage. We've done a few live things, which you can see on my website. If you click on the ZZ and me, I've got a couple of the videos of the early live iterations that we've done as well. So here is ZZ and me performing Anything You Can Do, I Can Do Better. Here we go. Oh, we've got some echo.
Any note you can sing, I can sing higher.
I can sing any note higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
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 How do you sing that high?
I'm a girl.
Anything you can say, I can say softer.
I can say anything softer than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Yes, I can.
There we go. Only a short extract, but you can watch the whole thing. Echoes, sorry. Am I still sharing the screen as well?
No, you're stunned.
That's odd. There we go. Yeah, so you can watch the whole 5 minute video as well on my website. So yeah, thank you.
That was fantastic. So really, queer utopias are a kind of common theme this evening. We were even talking about it on the way from the train station this evening. And I love the idea of queerness living in these digital spaces. I think that's really fascinating. I think we have some time for questions now. If anyone's got any questions that they want to ask, you can raise your hand or pop it into the chat.
I'm just going to see now.
Okay, good.
Uh,
question for you. Well, first of all, that was great. Thank you so much. Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of...
Definitely a lot of crossover, yeah.
Yeah, so it's really exciting. Yeah, I guess like, so I'm imagining myself obviously in this space, and what did the drag performers you were working with talk about? What was the response to kind of seeing themselves in this way or kind of melting together like that?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think there are some interesting responses to it for sure. I think the favorite was often the failures. I think that is what people kind of relished in the most. And that's an interesting point, that we're kind of at this point where AI is still in its infancy and it's still something that's being molded and shaped, and that we need to get more voices in molding and shaping that. But also that means that I think interesting kind of artifacts emerge out of that. And those become kind of the artistic expression often, I think, for me. So, for instance, we had Caramel, who is an amazing dancer, and they did a Beyoncé act, right? They fell into the splits in the middle of their performance and their sort of reference movement. But the thing is that our deep fakes hadn't been trained on anyone else doing the splits or that movement, right? So we didn't know what to do. So that was kind of a fantastic moment where I was watching 13 drag performers where I hadn't learned what they looked like in the splits, trying to create an image of them in the splits. And it's bizarre. It's like, if you go on the website and watch, Sweet Dreams, you'll see about 30 seconds in, like some of them like kind of dissolve into the floor and their kind of, you know, whole gown kind of literally like dissolves in a puddle of water, or their wig takes off as a sort of candy floss ice cream balloon. And yeah, they do really, really wonderful, bizarre things. So I think that was for a lot of people kind of seeing that sort of thing. But again, that is limitation in the data set. That is what we all should be talking about, is bias and limits of what the data set has learned and hasn't learned what to represent. And that might kind of come out as a drag performer failing to do the splits in a deep fake video, or it might come out as, you know, a huge problem for society in 5 years' time when it doesn't recognize the right people or thinks the wrong person's committed a crime or whatever it might be. So that was a fun moment, But also like the morphing faces, the way that drag performers wanted to see things when there wasn't really anything to see, when these are just kind of cold mathematical coordinates and these images don't exist, but they kind of were so sure they were seeing people that they knew and sort of ascribing meaning to these, you know, images created by a cold number crunching machine.
I was going to say, if anyone online, you're more than welcome to put your camera on and join in the conversation. I think we have probably about 20 participants or so. So, you know, feel free to
jump on the call.
Yeah. We're all here together.
How about yourself? How have you found collaborative technology? Have you kind of found there be moments where these things break down, or I don't know, where it surprised you maybe?
Absolutely. I think one of my favorite things that happens, and this happens a lot in the social VR space where everyone's using, you know, different qualities of models, different animations, things break, things glitch, things come down. One of the things I find most compelling is like to look down at your own hands, for example,